بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محموما، إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. أما بعد، tonight's topic is about a concept that has been mentioned in the Quran in four different places. And it talks about the concept of jahiliya. Jahiliya comes from the root word in the Arabic language, jahala. Jahala to mean one of two things. Jahala means to be ignorant of something, meaning that you have no knowledge of it. And it also means to be not only ignorant of it, but to act in ways that are contrary to it, meaning that to act in ignorant ways or in erroneous ways, or to act in ways that are to your disadvantage or to your disbenefit. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this concept in four different places. We'll touch upon these ayat and the reason why this term or this word jahiliyyah has been mentioned. And the word jahiliyyah means at large ignorance, be it ignorance of that which is good for you, or ignorance of the knowledge that you need to have. It's been mentioned in four different places to describe a social status or a social environment, if you will. So it is not just specific to the period before the coming of the Prophet Muhammad, but it rather includes that period, certain aspects of it, or many aspects of it. And even up to this day and age, we still witness a greater level of jahiliyyah, and we'll give some examples, inshallah. In the first place that is mentioned in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ. After the Sharia has been completed, and the Quran has been, you know, revealed upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the rules have been established in terms of how to interact with one another, the rights and obligations, family members, neighbors, business associates, in terms of punishment for, you know, certain crimes that have been committed. That's all prescribed in the Quran and in the Sunnah. So here, the masters or the elite of the society began to criticize the Quran. Why? Because in their perception, their treatment or the application of the judicial system in Islam, to them, ought not to be equitable or equal to that of their subservient. Meaning that, just like prior nations, if someone is to steal, if it's the master that steals, of course, and oftentimes the master steals out of greed, not out of a need, should not be treated the same way, or not the same punishment should be inflicted upon the master as if it would be inflicted on the slave if he is to steal. Similarly, if one is to commit zina, fornication, or murder, or so on and so forth, they did not want the same rules to be applied to the masters or the elite of the society as the rest of the society or the subservient, in their perception, the subservient aspect of the society. So this is one place. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemns them and say, أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ. They still wish, after this divine revelation descended upon them, to apply the judicial system of the day or the days of ignorance prior to the coming of the message of Islam. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ حُكْمًا مِنَ اللَّهِ لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Who is better of a judge, one who legislates, to a group of people who truly believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day? So this is the first place. The second place that the term or the concept jahiliyyah is mentioned, which is during Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, al-Hudaybiyah treaty, when the disbelievers, the mushrikeen, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ جَعَلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي صُدُورِهِمُ الْحَمِيَّةِ حَمِيَّةَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. That those who disbelieved, they refused to allow the Muslims to go into Mecca to perform the Hajj. Why? Because they feared that rest of the tribes around Mecca would say, oh, the Muslims have gotten strong and now they're able to perform the pilgrimage against the will of the disbelievers. So even in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, when the Prophet ﷺ said, let's begin this treaty, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the All Gracious, the All Merciful, the disbelievers said, أَمَّا الرَّحْمَنُ فَلَا نَدْرِي مَا الرَّحْمَنُ. As for Ar-Rahman, we don't know what that is, just write بِسْمِكَ اللَّهُمْ. So they refused to even acknowledge the second most personal noun name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in an effort to prevent against the bloodshed, he said, no problem, we'll take that one out. Then he said, this treaty is between the Prophet of Allah, Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so on and so on. They said, had we believed in you as a messenger, we would not have fought you. So therefore, take the word messenger out. Of course, some of the Muslims began to get agitated with this, including Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he went and asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and even Ali radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said that and commanded Ali to write, Ali refused to write. He said, I'm not going to take this one out. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, show me where it is and I will take it out. Out of hamiya for Islam, and this is the right action, but because they felt that Islam is being violated here. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's sanctity is being violated. So Umar radiallahu anhu went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam later and he said, Ya Rasulullah, O Prophet of Allah, aren't our martyrs in paradise and they're dead in the hellfire? He said, yes. He said, aren't we upon the truth and they're upon falsehood? He said, yes. And then the Prophet ﷺ looked at him and said, مَا كُنْتُ لِأَعْصِي اللَّهِ. He said, I'm not going to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything in this agreement is consistent with that which I was sent with. So not to deviate from the topic, then Umar ﷺ went to Abu Bakr and he asked him the same two questions that he asked the Prophet ﷺ. And the same two answers came as the Prophet ﷺ answered. Then Abu Bakr ﷺ realized what Umar is upset over and he said, إِلْزَمْ غَرْزَكْ. He says, stay put in your place and do not try to override the ranks. This is the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's not going to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, the word jahiliyyah is mentioned during the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah, indicating that the only reason why they prevented the Muslims from entering Mecca to perform the pilgrimage is because of the hamiyyah, the fanaticism, what people will say. So it has nothing to do with the truth. In fact, the truth was rather evident to them, because when the Quran was revealed, it was revealed as a challenge to those who are masters in the language. And they realized that this is truly the word of God, but because of their arrogance and their refusal to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they also refused to allow his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his followers to enter Mecca. That's the second place. In the third place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Battle of Uhud and the position of the hypocrites who wanted to stay in the Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the advice of many people among the Muslims, and at the end he made a decision to leave Medina and exit to the outskirts of Medina to face the disbelievers in that battle, in the Battle of Uhud. The hypocrites, because of their fear for themselves and their lives, and their disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Judgment Day, and they used to hide that, they wanted to stay in the Medina. So when the Muslims at the beginning of the battle won, the hypocrites were happy. They began to collect some of the spoils of war. And then the battle turned, and the Muslims began to sustain a defeat because of archers who disobeyed the Prophet ﷺ, descended from the mountain of Uhud and began to collect the spoils. And then, as we know, Khalid bin Walid came with a group of his military and he began to kill them one after the other. So they began, the victory started to turn into a defeat. And later, of course, turned into a victory again. But here in this position, the Muslims sustained tremendous damage and a lot of people were killed, especially those who memorized the Quran. So the hypocrites began to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them, يَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ ظَنَّ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. They began to think ill of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thinking, where's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How come we're not being victorious? How come we're being defeated? And many of us are being killed. So here they are thinking ill of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're not thinking of the implications to their disobedience of Allah, of the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they began to think of themselves and they said, يَقُولُونَ, had we stayed in the Medina, we would not have been killed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied to them and he said, قُلْ لَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ لَبَرَزَ الَّذِينَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقَتْلُ إِلَى مَضَاجِعِهِمْ. Say, even if you were in your own homes and it's time for you to die, then those who have expired or perished, if you will, shall be presented themselves, shall, against their will, of course, to the angel of death, and the angel of death will take their souls. So this has nothing to do with you being at the battleground, being inside the Medina or outside the Medina, being in your home, or even in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even if you're in fortified mansions or in fortified high places, you will still die when the time comes, and none can delay that, not even a split of a second. So this is the third place. The fourth place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to the mothers of the believers, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. And stay put in your homes, and do not cause yourself or expose yourself or expose your beauties beyond that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has permitted in terms of whether people that you can show your beauty to or exit in the household without the proper Islamic attire. So here, of course, is for the protection of women. So if we were to compare this particular scenario, where in the days of Jahiliyyah, a woman would expose the place of the earring, meaning that this part of the ear, that would be exposed to show her earring, or the place of the necklace, meaning that this part of the chest is exposed only to show the necklace. Now if you compare this act of Jahiliyyah prior to the coming of the Prophet ﷺ or shortly thereafter, and the acts of Jahiliyyah that we see now, we see that, of course, the Jahiliyyah of the 21st century far outweighs the Jahiliyyah of the days before the coming of the Prophet ﷺ or shortly thereafter. And of course, the objective behind that, of course, is to protect the chastity of women, to protect the honor of women, not to cause the lineage to be mixed up as a result of fornication and adultery and mingling and things of that nature. To perceive a woman with the respect and the honor and the dignity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given her by way of being a Muslimah. Unlike what we see now, where people want to exploit women every step of the way. They want to exploit them physically, they want to exploit their beauty, they want to exploit them in every aspect of the world in order to market their products and in order to fulfill their lower desires, you know, the animal desires, if you will, and in order to achieve many other objectives at the expense of, you know, women, and under the pretense that this is a freedom of choice, that a woman in this society is free to do whatever she wants with her body, with her this and that. And that is, of course, going to be furthest from the truth. It's nothing but an act of manipulation. It is nothing but an act of manipulation. So these are the four different places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the word jahiliyyah in the Quran. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he addresses Abi Dharr, and of course there is a dispute as to who Abu Dharr, you know, called, you know, Ibn al-Sawda, or the son of the black one. There's a dispute over this one, but the incident that has taken place, which mentioned in similar hadith and different narrations, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Abi Dharr, "Oh Abi Dharr, did you have an argument with so-and-so?" And Abu Dharr said, "Yes." He said, "Did you say this and that about his mother, that she is of a lower class, or she is not fit to be a mother either?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Innaka mri'un fika jahiliyyah." You are a man, there is jahiliyyah inside of you. Meaning that after the truth began evident to you, you've acted in ways that are contrary to that which is true and right course of action and right behavior. Similarly, the best of the best at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Al-Ansar, Al-Muhajirun. Al-Ansar meaning those who dwelled in the Medina when the Prophet ﷺ went there. And Al-Muhajirun are those who left Mecca running away for their Islam, and they joined Al-Ansar in the Medina. Now, in one incident, one member of the Ansar with another member of the Muhajirun, they had a conflict, and they began to launch words at one another. So one of them said, "Ya Al-Ansar," and the other said, "Ya Al-Muhajirun." Means that they're asking the help of each other's tribe, or each other's, you know, group, if you will. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أَفِي بِدَعْوَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ وَأَنَا بَيْنَ أَظْهُرِكُمْ. You call by the da'wa, the call of al-jahiliyyah, meaning that my pledge of allegiance is to my tribe. Right or wrong, I'm with them. My pledge of allegiance is to my people. Right or wrong, I'm with them. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم described that as a statement of jahiliyyah. And in fact, he added another narration where he says, دَعُوهَا فَإِنَّهَا مُنْتِنَا. دَعُوهَا فَإِنَّهَا مُنْتِنَا. Leave it, it stinks. It was not known that the Prophet ﷺ would use words like that. The Prophet ﷺ used the best of words. But this is the right word to use to describe this action. Because another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, إِيَّاكُمْ وَفَسَادُ ذَاتِ الْبَيْنِ. I am giving you a warning that you would disrupt relationships between you as Muslims. فَإِنَّهَا الْحَالِقَةِ. It is the shaver. أَلَا أَقُولُ تَحْلِقُ الرَّأْسِ. I do not say that it shaves the head. وَلَكِنَّهَا تَحْلِقُ الدِّينِ. It is the shaver of your deen. Means that it will waste your deen. And the Quran also speaks of that. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ تَفَرَّقُوا وَاخْتَلَفُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتُ. Do not be like those who divided and they split apart and they created conflicts among themselves in the deen that came to unite us, not to disunite us. So, in spite of the fact that we have that which truly unites us, we are disunited as Muslims. Why? In the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tongue of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, on judgment day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have a caller call. جَعَلْتُ نَسَبًا وَجَعَلْتُ النَّسَبًا. I have made one lineage, and you've made another. And this is really the crux of our talk tonight. This is really the underlying, you know, purpose or objective behind this talk. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, جَعَلْتُ نَسَبًا. I've established one lineage. وَجَعَلْتُمْ نَسَبًا. And you've established other lineages. فَأَبَيْتُمْ. You refuse but to say, the son of so-and-so is better than the son of so-and-so. And the son of so-and-so is better than the son of so-and-so. Why? Because of race. Because of social status. Because of positions. Because of money. This one is wealthy, this one is poor. Because of whatever justification you wanted to give, all of that collectively is no different from what Satan said when he was commanded to prostrate himself to Adam alayhi salam. He said, قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ. He said, I'm better than him. And I'm not going to prostrate myself to honor this creation. And then he began to come up with the reasons to justify his actions. And this is something every human being does. When they do something, they try to justify it, right or wrong. If you justify it wrong, of course that is arrogance. That is kibr. That the Prophet ﷺ said that none will enter paradise with even the weight of a mustard seed of kibr inside their heart. Arrogance. وَعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And he speaks of the Pharaoh and his followers, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعْلُوًا. They disbelieved in the miracles that Musa alayhi salam brought, even though internally they are completely convinced that this is the truth. The reason for them denying the truth, ظُلْمًا وَعْلُوًا, oppressing themselves, taking a position that they are not going to budge over, وَعْلُوًا, and out of arrogance. Their arrogance did not allow them to submit to the truth. Their arrogance did not allow them to submit to the truth. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on judgment day, or this munadi, this caller will say, فَالْيَوْمَ أَضَعُ أَنْسَابَكُمْ وَأَرْفَعُ نَسَبِي. Today I shall put all of your lineages down. Means that any criteria that you've established to create preferential, you know, treatment between one and the other, to elevate one over the other, all that will be put down. On the day that the only judge that matters is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَرْفَعُ نَسَبِي, and I will raise my lineage. What is the nasab that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed between the believers? He says in the Quran, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَإِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ بِنَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةً وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. O mankind, we have created you from one soul, from Adam alayhi salam. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ تَعَارَفُوا. And we have made you into different sects and tribes and different people. This one is from Bangladesh, this one from Pakistan, this one from Saudi Arabia, this is from Palestine, this is from this and that. So you'll come to know one another. So you will come to know one another. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honorable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala among you is the one who is most pious, is the one who is most righteous. And here the Prophet ﷺ says, لا فرق لعربي على عجمي من شيء إلا بالتقوى. Okay, ما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, that there is no difference, there is no favor that one will have over another except by way of taqwa. So if one wants to pride themselves of being anything, let them pride themselves of being first and foremost the Muslim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen this name for in the Quran. As he says in the Quran, هو سماكم المسلم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from above seven heavens chose this name for us as Muslims. من قبل, before the revelation of this Quran. وفي هذا, and in this Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the same name. So it's the same name from Adam alayhi salam all the way to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called his awliya. His awliya means the one he chose from the pool of people as fit to be guided, fit to be Muslims. هو سماكم المسلمين. He called you, he gave you the name Muslim. So we do not choose any other name for ourselves. من قبل, before the revelation of this Quran, وفي هذا, and in this Quran, لتكونوا شهداء على الناس ويكون الرسول عليكم شهيدا. So you'd be witnesses against people that this message has been delivered after the passing of the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ will witness over you. So one who calls another person with a derogatory name because of their race or the color of their skin or their mother tongue or because of the town they come from or because of the fact that they come from a poor community or this and that, this is a person who is actually committing shirk. How is that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. He is the one that divided our rizq. And our rizq is our talents, our material rizq, our knowledge, our piety, our righteous deeds, all of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided all of that among His creation. So when one says, you are from this town, your skin is too dark, you're this, you're that, so I'm better than you, this person is effectively saying, I object to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's created you this way. I'll mention a story just to further explain this. We all heard of Luqman al-Hakim. Luqman al-Hakim is mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored this man because of the knowledge and the wisdom and the taqwa that he had. And he narrates, you know, the story of Luqman in a few ayat and the advice that Luqman has given to his son. So Luqman used to be a slave, body and soul. He used to be a servant. He used to be a shepherd. In other words, it's not a person who was known to be physically attractive or known to have money or to have any of the shiny bubbles of this life. So at one point, you know, after he became knowledgeable and people would stand, literally would stand in line to go to Luqman al-Hakim, the wise man, to ask him about matters of Sharia. And he would answer one after the other. And those who stood in line, some of them are wealthy. Some of them come from the elite of the society. Some come from the regular, you know, segment of the society. So this man stood there staring at Luqman. And he's like recognizing this person, but he's amazed that he is now the Amir, if you will. He's now the one that people are going to him. So he went to him and said, aren't you the slave of so-and-so? He said, yes. He said, aren't you the shepherd that used to basically provide the service for so-and-so? He said, yes. So the man, as if he's like wondering as to why are you sitting here, as if you don't fit here. So Luqman understood this without any further words, and he said something to him. He said, أَتَعِيبُ الْخَلْقَ أَمِ الْخَالِقِ. He said, are you belittling the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referring to himself, or the creator himself? The man, of course, had no choice but to not say anything. So this is a man who truly earned the, you know, the title of Luqman al-Hakim, because he knew how to apply the Sharia and he knew how to explain to people things. So here, by telling him, أَتَعِيبُ الْخَلْقَ أَمِ الْخَالِقَ, you're making fun of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the creator himself. I am the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's the creator. He's the one who decreed how I should look, what social status I should occupy, what money I should have, what risk I should receive, all of that. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, in many, many places, you know, sets this record for us straight, including the Sahaba when they say, Bilal, you know, is our master and the son of our master. And notice that Bilal al-Habashi, the Muaddin, the one who used to call the Adan, used to be a slave, bought and sold and persecuted in the days of Jahiliyyah. And when he embraced Islam, it is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu who went and he ransomed him with his own wealth, and protected him from the persecution. And Umar, the second Amir, the second Khalifa, says, Bilal is our master and the son of our master. The Prophet ﷺ tells us in the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا أَجْسَامِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks not at your images, He knows what He has created. And He looks not at your bodies, He knows what He has created. He looks into your hearts and to your level of taqwa. He looks into your heart and your level of taqwa, the heart that the Prophet ﷺ says, أَلَا إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ بَاقِ الْجَسَدِ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ بَاقِ الْجَسَدِ. In this body, there is a mudra, there is, you know, a piece of flesh that if it's good, and subhanAllah, this term applies physically and spiritually as well. If it's good, then the rest of the body is good. And if it's bad, then the rest of the body is bad. And on Judgment Day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to be His awliya, His friends, His loved ones, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is no fear for them and there's nothing to be saddened over. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ Just two elements, two criteria that is mentioned in the Qur'an. Those who believed and they had taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the dwellers of paradise. These are the ones with the tremendous fortune that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes in many places in the Qur'an. So something, just a word of caution for us to be careful that when we meet someone and we immediately form an impression right off the start, I don't like this person. I don't like the way he looks. I don't like this, I don't like that. The question becomes, what Luqman al-Hakim has posed to his friend or the person who, أَتَعِيبُ الْخَلْقَ أَمِ الْخَالِقِ Are you making fun of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the creator himself? So, and also to remember that this is a statement of shirk as well. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives not that shirk is committed against him. And he forgives whatever he wills below that, beyond shirk or lesser than shirk, to whoever he wills. So here, if someone is objecting to the will and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they committed shirk. Sometimes this type of shirk is verbalized, wal-iyadhu billah. Sometimes we keep it in our hearts. If it's in our hearts, we need to cleanse it. We need to cleanse it of that. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a shepherd. And he was not known to be a wealthy man. And he was not known to be a man of a high social status. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an orphan. He was an orphan. And yes, Banu Hashim, the people of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were honorable people. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises one above the other, as he says in the Qur'an, تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ He preferred the prophets one over the other. مِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَلَّمَ اللَّهِ Then he mentions how the preferential choice was made. Is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَلَّمَ اللَّهِ The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Moses has given him a very high status. But that's by way of his lineage to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابَ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ Be Rabbani means closely connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your status to be raised up high. By way of learning the book, the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by way of applying it. So any preferential treatment that one wishes to pride themselves with is the fact that they're a Muslim. I will conclude with this one short story where Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he sent Abi Dharr radiallahu anhu, he sent him to open Al-Quds, and it was under the occupation of the Christians back then. So here, the spiritual Christian leaders refused to give the keys except to Amir al-Mu'mineen. So a messenger was sent to him, and he was informed, and then he said, okay, he summoned his servant, Salim, he had a servant with him, and he refused to even take a second dabba, another, camel or horse to ride from Bayt al-Mal. He said, no, I will use my own, and you and I will take turns. Notice, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Khalifa, the number one man among the Muslims, is going to be taking turns with his servant who is going to ride and who is going to walk. So, out of concern for his servant, he said, O Salim, let me ride first, so this way you are spared from the tongues of people. Where people would not say, Salim is riding and his master is walking. So out of concern for his servant. So Salim accepted. So he rode. So he said, along the way, what are we going to do? The one who's riding is going to recite the Quran. And the one who's walking is going to basically check his memorization. And when they alternate, then now Salim is riding and Amir al-Mu'mineen is walking. So Salim now is reciting the Qur'an, Amir al-Mu'mineen is checking his, memorization. And they kept on doing that up until they reached Al-Quds. Now, when they reached Al-Quds, it was Salim's turn to ride. So he was riding. So Salim said, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, I see people in the distance. I think it's better for you to ride and for me to walk. He said, O Salim, stay put in your place. By Allah, I am not in less need of my hasanat than you. And you are not in less need of your hasanat than I. You stay put in your place. He took his shoes off as he's walking through muddy grounds, raises his thobe, and he's walking in the mud. So when he reaches Bayt al-Maqdis, everybody's waiting for him. And now the leader on the Muslim military is looking at Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, what are you doing? These are people who like ominous displays when a leader walks into town. He said, you be quiet. He said, you be quiet, because by Allah, we are a people that we were, you know, in a state of humiliation before the revelation of the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'azzana bil Islam. He honored us with this Islam. فَإِنْ ابْتَغَيْنَا الْعِزَّةَ فِي غَيْرِهِ أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. If we were to seek izzah, glory, might and power in anything aside from Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put us back in a state of humiliation. He said, these people are honorous because of our Islam, not because of what we have in terms of the material worth. So here the spiritual leaders began to count the holes that Umar had in his thobe. And they counted 17. When they've counted 17 and they met Umar, they went in a state of sujood. When they raised their heads, he asked them, why did you do that? They said, we read in our books that the one who's gonna receive the keys of Al-Aqsa is a leader of the believers that will have 17 holes in his thobe, and he will come on a dabba where his boy is riding, his servant is riding, and he is walking. And now we see it happen. And they gave him the keys to Al-Aqsa. He went in a sajda of shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Salat al-Isha. According to the narrators, he stayed in a state of sujood until Salat al-Fajr. This is the Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to pride ourselves with. This is the Islam that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come with. If we're to compare that with other, those called religious people, we see that Islam is far superior. There's no comparison, in fact. We see the superiority of Islam and the moral character that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to perfect ought to be displayed every step of the way in us as Muslims. So, you know, with that, you know, the issue of segregating ourselves and dividing ourselves into sects and groups based on religion, based on ethnicity, based on schools of thought, based on this or that, is nothing but a state of jahiliyyah that we are perpetuating, not because of Islam, but in spite of Islam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to, or to allow us to understand our deen in the best possible way. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us the truth, to show us the true path, to unite us upon the truth. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to live in a true state of Islam and to cause us to die in a state of Iman. أقول قولي هذا واستغفره سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.